Let me start that. Yes. So please keep your mic muted for the duration of the presentation. If you wish to ask a question during the Q&A segment at the end, you may unmute your mic or leave your questions in the chat and I'll feed them to Dr. Lawrence. 3, for data collection, internal purposes, I will be putting a contact card on your screen where you can input your information. Kindly complete this while I introduce our speaker this evening. And lastly, please do not use profanity or inappropriate language, again, because it will be recorded. So let me put that up for you. So again, thank you all for joining us this evening for our presentation. This evening's presentation is led by Dr. MoniKa Lawrence of UCCI, and her presentation is entitled The Discovery of Self Through the Empowerment from Dance. So Dr. MoniKa Lawrence holds a PhD in Cultural Studies from the University of the West Indies. She also studied in the USA, South Africa, and Israel in several disciplines. Dr. Lawrence is currently Associate Professor and Artistic Director of the Performing Arts at University College of the Cayman Islands. After joining UCCI, she has developed dance and cultural courses. She was awarded in 2013 the International Association of University Presidents Achievement Award in recognition of her excellence in the performing arts at UCCI. In 2021, she was awarded the Students' Choice Outstanding Faculty Award. She brings a wealth of experience in teaching, performing, and artistry in the development and introduction of courses in dance and related areas. Dr. Lawrence is founder and artistic director of the Stella Maris Dance Ensemble of Jamaica. The dance company was founded in 1994 and is renowned for its innovative presentations both internationally and locally in Jamaica. She was also a principal dancer and choreographer with the National Dance Theater Company of Jamaica under the direction of the late Honorable Professor Rex Nettleford. So welcome everyone, welcome Dr. Lawrence, and over to you.
Thank you, Brian. I'd just like to welcome everyone today to this presentation. I'd also like to also extend a thank you to the National Museum for partnering with UCCI. And a special shout out to Brian Wattler, my Cayman son, as the conceptualization of these lectures are his brainchild. Education must provide students with skills for life. Tonight, we will explore this statement and together discover how dance is used to educate its practitioners. I will attempt to confirm the theories with practical examples throughout my presentation. Frequently, when you suggest to a student that they should be involved in an area of the performing arts, their response is commonly, I can't sing, I can't dance, I can't act, I can't play an instrument. Then the body next comes into focus. I am not flexible, I'm too tall, too fat. The excuses are endless. In fact, the student typically only thinks about the stage presentation, which is the cherry on top of the cake, because one has to bake the cake first, and this requires several ingredients. Everybody will not progress to the concert stage, nor do they necessarily aspire to that level of performance. Alternatively, there are many other areas in the arts, costume design, stage management, lighting, front of house management, videography, advertising, promotion, among other opportunities. Before an audience views the finished product on the stage, let me indulge you in some of the benefits a dancer will experience. This comprises a journey which educates them in navigating life and making discrete successes at the same time. I will start with a promo that I used for Stella Maris.
Hey.
So let's get into the meat of the subject matter. Let's talk about the creative imagination and visualization, which is one of the benefits of dance. The creative imagination, guys, is the fuel that empowers individuals. Let me explain that. An idea begins in the mind of a choreographer. We communicate through the mind with our innermost feelings and emotions, sometimes reaching heights of spirituality and ecstasy. Our thoughts then communicate with our body, which is a canvas. The choreographer's thoughts and body communicate with the dancers within the confines of our surroundings. The dancers then communicate with the choreographer, whose creativity they are expected to make manifest. Ultimately, the dancers communicate with an audience. Being a two-way street, the audience in turn communicates with the performers through the senses, primarily through visual interpretation. Through visual communication, they experience what is known as a kinesthetic response involving movement, sensation within the body. This life lesson is about one becoming a master at visualization. Let us focus at this point on the mindset. Visualization is an extraordinary powerful skill. You may have heard of the law of attraction or manifestation. Your brain is a filter and it is constantly looking for evidence. The brain is a powerful stimulator and this is the root of the creative process. How do dancers use visualization to their advantage? The technical term is that your brain has a reticular activating system, which is a filter system that allows certain information into your brain while it blocks out other information. Who programs that filter? You do. If you think it and see it, you can become it and achieve it. Yes, I can. And in embracing visualization, one builds self-worth, confidence, positive emotions, and embraces a path to becoming productive individuals. If you think negatively, for example, if you think that somebody does not like you, your reticular activating system is going to look for evidence to prove that thought. Your brain does not, without urging, distinguishes what is factual and what is imaginary. You have to program it. Hence, you must program it in a positive way. The idea begins in the mind, creates the vision. You allow others to see it too, and then it becomes reality. Consequently, dancers master visualization because they see and become a part of the creation of that dance, whether or not it is simple or complex. For example, I remember years ago teaching at a prep school, and the children were 7, 8, and 9 year olds at the time. And they had an international reggae competition. And we decided that, Patsy Ricketts and myself decided that we were going to enter these youngsters, six of them, in this competition. They went through the different processes and all that sort of thing. Now, part of teaching them the dance, what I did was that I went as far as to let them visualize winning. So I would do an interview with them. What's your name? The camera, you know, all the TV cameras, the cameras are flashing. What's your name? I'm Wendy Holford. And what's your name? I'm Karen Seymour. And how does it feel to be the winner? And then they would rehearse all of that sort of thing. And what are you going to do now? You know, okay. The performance night came up and we were, it was an international reggae competition. We were called into the judges' room. And the judges said to myself and Patsy, we have a problem. And I said to them, we have a problem? They said, yes, because your youngsters are emerging, the winners of the competition. However, they cannot take up the awards because the award was to tour with the band and dance and all of these are 7, 8, 9 year olds. I said to them, you have to give them the first place. I know we cannot take up the different awards. However, you made that mistake. You did not stipulate an age limit, right? Well, they did announce them as the winners, but of course we could not take up, you know, the majority of the prize and everything. But the point is that they saw themselves as the winners. They even rehearsed as if they were the stars before they even started. That's visualization. In dance, negative thoughts are not encouraged. Performers are encouraged to cultivate what you call a diva personality of themselves. This involves thinking positively of themselves in order to gain the sustained attention of their audience. If you think you look silly, you will look silly. Consequently, by visualizing the dance, executing the steps, embracing the concept and dramatization, the sequence becomes a reality on the concert stage. Hence, you are teaching them to use their creative imagination, gain technical competence, and master the power of visualization. This method becomes a life obsession for performers. If you see it in your mind's eye, you can achieve it. The idea begins in the mind. It creates the vision. You allow others to see it too, and then it becomes a reality. Let's look at another area, a holistic approach. Through the medium of dance, one learns various genres of music, dance styles, and techniques. They become knowledgeable in their history, hence embracing nationalism, among other experiences. I'm going to now show you a video of the university dancers. And dance has no borders. This is a French signature dance. At first, when we knew we had to learn this dance, the can-can, they were scared. How am I going to kick? How am I going to execute that? How am I going to sustain the energy? Look at them. Thank you. Dance has no borders. The scale of dances one finds in the Caribbean ranges from salsa, rumba, dancehall, mento, reggae, gere, revival, kumina, tumbo, tambu, etu, merengue, shango, dinky mini, tuzella, and bamba, and others to name a few. They all share the foundation of African rhythms and movements overlaid with some European influence. Now let's look at an Afro-Caribbean dance that embraces all these different dances, choreographed by Orville Hall and myself, and again, the university dancers.
Thank you.
Hope you were entertained. Now let's look at a holistic historical perspective. In review of the literature, the European influence, while significant, is never dominant enough to obliterate or radically change the essence of the African contribution. Hence, Caribbean dancers have an acute understanding and respect for their African roots. Many Caribbean dances continue to bear African names or names which have been slightly amended. The African presence also remains linguistically apparent. I will now go, I cannot talk about dance without including the late Professor Rex Nettleford. And he was the Vice Chancellor of the University of the West Indies, but he was also the Artistic Director and Founder of the National Dance Theatre Company of Jamaica. And I'm going to show you a very brief segment of three of his dances. That these dances for the concert stage were inspired from rituals in Jamaica. These rituals are practiced by a minority of the society, but they are Jamaican. They are part of the history of a country. They are still being practiced even today in the society. And recently through UNESCO, the revivalism was named one of Jamaica's intangible cultural heritage. Now these dances were choreographed between one was choreographed in the 60s, one was choreographed in the 70s, and the other in the 80s. And he went into the field, took these rituals and brought them to the concert stage. But before I tell you about them, you have to see them in order to understand what I'm talking about.
Thank you.
Okay, let's go to nationalism. How did he achieve this? Netophon's ability to insert nationalism into heretofore rituals is a testament to his vision. These are staged and conceptualized as rituals in a stylized context, but Netophon never loses sight, nor does he allow his audience to forget that these rituals are ancestral rhythms, narratives, and functions. These works, as I said before, was choreographed within from 1962, which was one generation of dancers coming in. In 1970s, another generation of dancers coming in. And in 1980s, another generation of dancers coming in. That was their baptism into the rituals of Jamaica, that he decided that it was necessary for the people to know about them. And the only way, because the normal person would not be going into these hinterlands to research and to look at them. He had to bring them to the concert stage to bring a consciousness about them. So nationalism within the 60s was very popular in Jamaica. That was the year of their independence. How that reality would be played out was of great concern to every thinking Jamaican. Independence and the symbols of nationality were given to the lignum vitae, the national flower, ackee, the national fruit, and the combination of ackee and saltfish as the national dish, and of course, the national bird, the doctor bird. Self-government had, after all, been foremost in the minds of the politicians and the intellectuals. Netophon was a part of this group growing up in modern Jamaica. His role was to keep two currents going. One was education, and the other was the exercise of the creative imagination expressed through the dance. How was he able to achieve this? The populace was able to make a connection between themselves and these three works. Even if they did not reflect personal belief systems, people were able to understand that they did reflect a national consciousness. More Jamaicans today know at least the names of these traditional rituals: Pokomania, Kumina, and Geri. They may not understand them all, but they know that they are certainly and uniquely Jamaican. I personally knew about these rituals through dance, and then becoming a mentor of mine, Netophon, and then doing research. That's how I knew about them. And I grew up in Jamaica. I didn't know about them until I entered the dance world, right? These three dances are artistically sound, and they also represent a liminal connection to the ethos of the Jamaican people. As such, these dances remain important as organic archival works that one can access for information. Let's now look at the African retention. Netophon's use of the creative imagination, nationalism, and now the African retention as part of his artistic and intellectual armory are evidenced in his choreography and his writings. Netophon's stance on the body as being a force is also revealed in his choreography. The body is one of the few things over which one really has personal control. He reclaims the dancing body as a way of commentary on the enslavement and colonial periods. Bondage for him is metaphysical. The body for Netophon is a canvas on which he paints his many stories. He uses the Black dancing body to establish several important points, and I will just go through three of them with you. first that the Jamaican dancing body could enter and maintain a presence on the world stage using indigenous material. The national company, before his passing in 2010, the National Dance Theatre Company would always take at least one of these dances on any world tour that they went on. They have been to as far as Russia, Australia, North and South America, and the Caribbean. Okay? And at least one of these rituals are always on the program. Another thing is that the creative imagination can and does operate as a conscious tool for exploring and expressing Jamaicans' myth, history, lore, and spiritual beliefs. Another thing about the Black dancing body is that the African retentions, the continuities present and evident throughout Jamaica, can be celebrated, highlighted, and mined for the inherent richness and unique qualities. Let's talk about the process. The process is evident in Nettlefold's three neo-traditional works. I call them neo-traditional because once you take a ritual from the field and put it on the concert stage, there are certain components and certain things that you have to take out of it. One main one being the spirituality of it. You don't bring it on the stage, but that's for another lecture. All right? So these three neo-traditional works, starting with an idea which is communicated to the participants through interaction, comradeship, and physical engagement. Nettlefold confirms this when he says, the dance is not only a performing art, but also an art of community effort that proclaims the virtue of cooperation over unrestrained individualism. Hence, a dancer learns to communicate with others because dance is not a solo act. This process is the route to the performance stage, as the dance not only becomes a tool for research, but the dancers in turn discover the cultural wealth of rural traditional Jamaica in their exploration for creative and imaginative interpretation. He actually took his dancers into the field to study and observe firsthand the folk traditions. This was done to teach his dancers, the singers, the musicians, which you all saw on the stage, how to connect and identify with their culture whilst gaining respect for it and communicating it to a wider audience at home and overseas on the concert stage. By bringing these Jamaican ritual dances into the consciousness of Jamaicans and the world, Nettlefold critically engages the notion of art for life's sake, rather than art for art's sake. And in doing so, he blurs the line between high art and low art. Philosophically, his position was clear. He believed that rituals were part and parcel of a belief system that could be mined for information. That the music and dance of the people from the folk class, which is the lower class, represented art and should be accorded value and prominence in the culture. Also, that a holistic approach to Jamaican culture was necessary to fully comprehend and the intertextuality and scope of the culture. Music, dance, spoken word, costume, masking, masquerade were all part of one, and it should be presented as such because the creative process is not monodimensional. I will now share with you what do I mean also by monodimensional, in that this is an excerpt from a ballet that I choreographed for the Stella Maris dancer, Some Liza. It's a full-length ballet about a girl who lives in rural Jamaica, and she got tired of living in the country and decided to move to Kingston, which is the town area. Of course, that comes with certain glitz and glamour that she's not accustomed to, of which, being a young girl, she falls in love with a guy there. And of course, you know, the guy has his other girlfriend. And so there's a clash between them. And she decides, you know, I want a simpler life. And she goes back to the country. And the guy decides to follow her back to the country. So what I'm going to show you now is when he goes to the country, she introduces him to her people, and of course, they're going to get married, and all hell break at the wedding. All right? This is showing you that through mime and drama, using gesticulations to communicate, that dance does not always have to be about just movement, and so you can use drama to communicate it. So let's look at Liza. This is the mother meeting the boyfriend for the first time.
Baby, we could take it slow. I swear it must be Cupid shooting arrows with his bow. I notice in your eyes a certain glow. I'm here wondering now, is it really me or tell me, do you feel the same? I feel like I'm in love and I don't even know your name. I know what I'm saying to you, may sound pretty lame. Your love is like an everlasting flame. So what this scene calls service us?
I really don't know, but this spirit is anyway, the same
way we said it, and I'm trying to flow. And what this thing got
me, Casa? I really don't know. From the way that she smiled, I can tell how the story would go.
Chica bonita,
you're pretty like a rose.
Mi señorita,
never
want you
a pose.
Dame un beso,
y'all tell me the show.
Toca mi vida,
and everybody knows.
Chica bonita,
you're pretty like a rose.
Mi señorita,
never
want
you a pose.
Dame un beso,
y'all tell me the show.
Toca mi vida,
and everybody knows. Lovely lady, please give me your signal so I know you understand. Maybe I should stop by making gestures with my hand. Girl, you're like a rising star and I'm your biggest fan. I see bonita diva with the tan. Got me thinking, baby, we could make our life together on the ocean shore. Paradise is where you are, I'm ready to explore. Can never get enough of you, it's all about a more. And happiness is knocking at your door. So what this thing called service?
I really don't know, but this spirit is in the way to sit
and the night I would go. And what this thing called me, sir?
I really don't know. From the way that she smelled, I could tell how the story would
Chica bonita, señorita, dame un beso, toca mi vida, chica bonita, señorita, dame un beso, toca mi vida, chica bonita, señorita, dame un beso, toca mi vida, chica bonita.
You're pretty like a rose,
señorita.
Girl, I want you a pose.
Dame un beso.
Y'all tell me the truth. Toca mi vida. And everybody knows. Tell me what you wanna do, where you wanna go. Ain't no need to rush it, baby, we could take it slow. I swear it must make you be shooting arrows with this bow. I notice in your eyes a certain glow. I'm here wondering now, is it really me or tell me, do you feel the same? I feel like I'm in love and I don't even know your name. I know what I'm saying to you, may sound pretty lame. Your love is like an everlasting flame. So what this thing called service house?
I really don't know, but this spirit is in me, the city and I tell
you. And what this thing called me, Casa?
I really don't know. From the way that she smiled, I can tell how the story would go. Chica bonita,
you're pretty like a rose.
Mi señorita, dame un beso. Toca mi vida. Chica bonita,
you're pretty like a rose.
Mi señorita,
dame
un beso. Toca mi vida.
Please give me your signal so I know you understand. Maybe I should stop by making gestures with my hand. Girl, you're like a rising star and I'm your biggest fan. I see Bonita Diva with the tan. Got me thinking, baby, we could make our life together on the ocean shore. Paradise is where you are, I'm ready to explore. Can never get enough of you, it's all about amor. And happiness is knocking at your door. So what this thing called service
is? I really don't know, but this spirit is in the way to set it up and down
and flow. And what this thing called Mikasa?
I really don't know. From the way that she smiled, I can tell how the story would go. Chica bonita,
you're pretty like a rose.
Mi señorita,
me
love how you
are posed.
Dame un beso,
y'all tell me
the toca mi vida.
And everybody knows from the lady with you. Please give me your signal so I know you understand. Maybe I should stop by making gestures with my hand. Girl, you're like a rising star and I'm your biggest fan. I see Bonita Diva with the tan. Got me thinking, baby, we could make our life together on the ocean shore. Paradise is where you are, I'm ready to explore. Can never get enough of you, it's all about amor. And happiness is knocking at your door.
Okay, that was Liza. So you see, dance is not monodimensional. The impact of colonialism continues to inform the Caribbean consciousness. The legacy of colonialism is the pervasive denigration and devaluing of all things Black and derived from Africa. It will require generations to erase this mindset. In the meantime, stewards of the dance should take up Nettlefa's mantle by taking every opportunity to dramatically and visually demonstrate that Black is indeed beautiful. Dance was and still is a wonderful vehicle to convey this, despite its ephemeral nature, because dance has the ability to excite, educate, illuminate, and celebrate all in one show. In conclusion, through dance, a child learns the meaning of process, and by this is better able to relate outcome to effort. Dance do in fact educates and does in fact give students skills for life. I will conclude with a statement made by my mentor, Rex Nettleford. As I said before, former Vice Chancellor of the University of the West Indies and Artistic Director of the National Dance Theatre Company for 48 years. In a personal interview with me as a researcher, he said to me, and I quote, "I used my mind," which is what he's talking about, his intellect, "to write my essays and get my distinctions. But when I really wanted to speak, it was the dance. End of quote. I will now introduce it to my senior UCCI dancers and my Stella Maris dance ensemble, not babies anymore. Thank you all, and if you have any questions.
Thank you, Mother Lawrence. Great presentation. It's like taking your Caribbean dance and culture class all over again. But it's what we need to see more of, the arts and the creative imagination, especially here in Cayman. But your presentation inspired me. I might do a presentation on Cayman quadrille. We'll see.
That's my boy.
Okay, I see we have Jared. McGill has his hand up. Jared, you can go ahead.
Yes, the question that I have, which it could be a fault of mine. Could you talk about how the ancestors used dance as a way of escaping, I don't know, I guess their situation? Could you talk a little bit about that? Because I don't hear much about that in books. Or do you know of any books pertaining to that where it talks about it?
First of all, when you talk about our ancestors, I'm speaking about our African ancestors, and the thing about it is that it is the Europeans that separated music, dance, and music. That was all one big component. There was no separation between them all in the when you're talking about dance in terms of rituals or ancestors. If you could play music, you are a dancer. And if you could dance, you play music and you could sing, right? It is the European that has separated it. And music was to celebrate everything. In early rituals, if they were even going to war, if they were going to plant, it was a dance. It was a musical thing. If they came back from hunt, the therapy of it was just to dance what happened in the hunt. If they went to war with another tribe, it was to dance about what happened. So dance, music was and song was everything to them. It was a way of life. It was not separate, right? So it plays an integral part. That is why it is so important for us to look at what are the indigenous rituals within different countries and all that, because apart from the music, the movement that they do is wonderful for you to extend your dance vocabulary with. And not to mention the music, because the music now, even within Jamaica, the ancestral rhythms, whether it be the Kumina, the Revival, all of those, they are now in the dancehall space. You hear the ritual, you hear the rhythms in the dancehall space. So it is something that is, you know, it's very rich in terms of continuity and, you know, where it started and where it is today. I hope that answered your question.
Okay, Young.
Dr. Lawrence, a very insightful presentation and makes me go back to those old days when you put Kumina and all those things as a part of your presentation. I just want to thank you for this wonderful presentation.
Thank you, Dr. Young.
Dr. Lawrence. I just want to remind people that dance is a way of life for the African people and for us in the African retention, a way of life. Not just something that you do for, you know, to get yourself away from issues. It's a way of life.
Right. That's Lorna, right?
Yes, it is.
Dr. Cooper.
Yes, good evening, everyone. And thank you so much, Dr. Lawrence. That was very insightful, entertaining, and really took me back, like Dr. Young said. I realized, I was thinking it when you said it, that I had so many vicarious experiences through dance. I had never in Jamaica gone to a Kumina session, nor have I been to a barnyard and all that, but I got exposed to those things through what I saw through what Rex Nettleford put on the stage. So when you spoke about holistic history weekend you spoke about nationalism that resonated for me. And I wondered, and this is the question, whether if you have, through any of your teachings or your choreographies, done the same, celebrated K-Man, so that through the dances, the teachings, the choreographies, to what extent have you exposed your students to K-Man, exposed K-Man to the students, and even perhaps exposed K-Man culture to an international stage?
Well, we have through with the museum collaborated in the Junkuna Festival. We have done the quadrille at our yearly spring concert. Bran was a big part of teaching the quadrille that year. So we have exposed the dancers. We have taken them to different cultural sites where they have actually spoken with practitioners with the Junkuna and in some of the quadrille music, right? And all that, they have done that. And the university dancers have toured extensively in terms of going to Carifest and presenting, Cayman culture on the stage. They have been to Barbados, they have been to Trinidad, and recently they were at Dance Umbrella in Jamaica. So they have been exposed to it, but there's obviously much more that we can do within Cayman, but it's a process and we're getting there.
Hi, MoniKa, Dr. Lawrence. Denise Robinson here.
Denise was a past member of the National Dancers Company.
Yes. I just wanted to make reference to what somebody was talking about, the escape, dance as an escape. And let's follow up with something that Lorna also said, it's a way of life. And really the two things are not separate, because dance is a very spiritual experience. That those of us who have performed know that you can actually reach in the performance, you can actually reach into a space where you dissolve and you become and you're open or you open up to another level of awareness, that even sometimes when you come off the stage, you don't even know like who was that. so the word escape, it has a funny connotation that, it's not so good, but it's actually opening up a portal to the unconscious, to that space that you don't normally tap into. And if you are really in sync, there is so much information that can come through to you, not just from a cerebral point of view, but from at a cellular level. And that is why the arts in general, because I work with visual arts as well, and that's a similar kind of response that occurs, so just to I think to maybe put some clarity around that idea of escape / way of life. And yeah, find the fact that we are all spiritual beings, and we forget that, and the dance, the visual arts performing generally does open us up to recalling or remembering and becoming much more aware of who we are, more of us, more of you to you.
Yeah. Kimal.
Kimal.
Good evening, everyone. And
Kimal.
It's so good to see you, Dr. Lawrence. and of course, I loved watching your presentation. It was very insightful. And of course, there are so many fond memories of watching your choreographies for obvious reasons. But I wonder if you could talk a little, you talked a lot about African retentions, which I think is really important. And I wanted to know a little bit more about how you provide historical, sociological, or any other kind of epistemological context for your students when you're teaching them the dances, and particularly about origins and influences and so forth.
Yeah, I emphasize the African retention because that is underplayed very often. Mm-hmm. And I sort of grew up believing that, it was something that was not to be celebrated, and, there was low art and all that sort of thing. So my emphasis is always on celebrating, my Blackness, mm-hmm. so to speak. But the dancers themselves, dance for me is a universal thing. So it is not just about doing what I feel comfortable with, but also teaching them other genre of dances, right? And hence you have Mama Kariyama's technique that you the that you teach Kemal, and we try to embrace them all and make it unique, because we are so mixed. We are so mixed that, as I said before, dance has no borders. So it is constantly, but giving them the respect of for what is their own. And let to me, it is very important, because that's how I had learned, you know, it, to respect my own and to look within and try to find more of what is there instead of always looking outside. Which is important for me. And I try to do that with my students, to get let them get a respect for their own before they can start, you know, looking outside to find acceptance.
Thank you.
Dr. Liv?
Thank you, Prof. That was such a delight listening to it. I just enjoyed it so much, especially when you spoke about the dance as an anti-colonial tool. You know, that's really very, very lovely. I wanted to ask you a question more on the side of religion. My suspicion is that the church community is not necessarily very comfortable sometimes with these wonderful rhythms and so on. If I'm correct in my thinking, what would cause that? And how do we get them to be more friendly to these
wonderful rhythms? What did you say about religion?
Yeah, I wanted to ask you, my suspicion is that the church community is probably not as welcoming of these, I mean, wonderful artistic expressions coming from our African situation. If I'm correct in my thinking, I think, what would cause this? How do we, you know, let them take on these wonderful things?
I think what happens is that when people do not understand something, right, they tend to shy away from it. Also, you must understand that even within the rituals, taking them, remember what I spoke about, I said the neo-traditional, in that when you take a ritual from the field, from its space that it is created and what it is created for, and put it on the concert stage, it's a very delicate and intricate thing, you know, because there are certain things that you cannot bring on the concert stage. Even the rhythmic patterns of the drum, all that sort of thing. You, there are certain things that you cannot bring on the concert stage, and it takes a certain amount of understanding and research for you to realize that if the rhythm is played a certain way and for a long period of time, it might throw the dancers into another space. If, for example, in revival, there is what they call a table, and if you set that table, if you actually reproduce that setting and that whole construct, you're invoking certain things. You don't do that. So what you're doing is you're doing a sort of extraction, taking out the just the essence of what that entails and making it, putting on a creative armor around it. Because to take some a ritual from the field to put it on the stage is a very serious thing. And it's not everybody can do it. Even within how long do I keep that rhythm going? It's like going to church. You know, you have some churches that you go to and they will sing the same chorus. It seems like about 30 times. And when they keep singing, people start to get off. And I just keep singing the same chorus, the same chorus, the same chorus. No. So what happened within, for example, if you look at Nettlefoss Kumina, what he did was that he was on the rhythm of Kumina, the rhythm of it. And then suddenly he breaks it into the stick fight. So what happens there is that you break from that rhythm into something else. Then it goes off into another pattern. So you never truly get caught up completely into that rhythm to be spiritually affected by it. You know? So as I said, the churches, for me, I know you won't quote the Bible, but it talks about dance and music and all that, but some churches do not entertain it. I know I'm Roman Catholic and we do entertain dance, you know, so it's because they don't know. What you don't know, you tend to fear.
Right, because the question the gentleman asked a while ago, I wondered if it's because it's probably two different epistemologies. Which I kept side by side, and as you mentioned, are not sufficiently speaking to each other.
But Dr. Lynn, even today, what they have clerical dancing. You know, it is now an art. It is now a separate art form where people are trained to do dances within the church, even the way they dress. It has now become an art form. You know. In order to remain respectable, how do you do the movements? How do you dress? How do you interpret the movements and all of that sort of thing? It happens within the churches. So some churches do embrace, while others, no.
Dr. Cooper.
Thank you. I'm going to, unfortunately, have to leave relatively soon, so I'm going to ask two questions, Dr. MoniKa. I hope you don't mind. The first one, I really enjoyed your discussion of visualizing what you want to become, the story of the 9-year-olds who won because they saw themselves as winners. And I just wondered where, from your experience, especially as it relates to Cayman, have you seen this whole idea of visualizing what you want to become being transferred amongst the dancers you have been training, especially as it relates to perhaps their academic and or professional lives? So to what extent have the dance impacted this visualizing of themselves as winners? And to what extent have you seen from your realistic experiences that they have taken this over to their academic and professional lives? That's one.
Well, to be quite frank, I'm glad you asked that question, because in the short time that I've been here, and remember, I get the my dancers come after high school, okay? So they are after high school, so you get them at a very mature stage. And I have definitely seen the impact of the discipline of the arts on my students, because I have seen them aspire for greater things. I have seen them come in very shy and reserved and very opinionated as to, I can do it. And when you look, you say to yourself, you're just starting out, you know, and all that. And I have seen them humble their spirits and I have seen them achieve. And it is all through the, you know, through the training, through the interaction with them, the exposure that they have received by going abroad and looking at things, and also to the extensive, the amount of different techniques that you throw at them, right? Because they're trained from ballet with Miss Jackie to modern contemporary to, you know, African rhythms and all that. And there is definitely a change among them, definitely so. And you can, a testament to this is the fact that you have dancers who have actually, since I've been at the university, that have actually gone overseas, have gained their first degree, and have returned to dance with the dance group, you know?
So awesome.
That to me is enough to say that, you know, whatever we're doing clearly is impacting them in a positive way.
And it kind of then leads into my next question, because your answer has probably even answered it somewhat, but it's what I wanted to ask is, what do you then say to those academic institutions that do not value the performing arts, dance, music as something integral, or those who might think it irrelevant and so might remove it from their suite of offerings? What are they actually
doing an injustice. An injustice to the young mind, because especially in the Caribbean, when music and dance and all that is such an integral part of our whole being, and you do not expose them to it, right? You do not, if you just think about even socialization, just being able to socialize, right? The friendship that these youngsters, the interaction that they have among themselves, you will never find anywhere. Because what happens is that they become so entwined with each other, because you see them in a celebratory mood. You see you, they see you at your worst, at your best. The friendship that they build. I've had that. I think one of the most encouraging things to me once was one of my dancers, a male dancer, and I said to him, Bushman, I know you have a girlfriend. How come we haven't seen your girlfriend? And all this time and everywhere we go. And he looked at me and he says, because this is my family. That's another family. This is my family. That meant a lot to me. You know what I mean? Because the interaction that you find within the group, any performing group, is wonderful. And every young person needs that. And that is just one aspect of the training. Just one. Glenn.
Okay. Dr. Lawrence, wow. Congratulations. That has been a phenomenal presentation. Incredibly insightful. I literally just felt you were completely on point on literally every aspect, from, you know, starting off with, you know, the experience young people have when they're having to visualize something, you know, all the way to what, you know, the late Professor Netford basically shared with you. Given the historical, you know, sort of impact that, you know, the African sort of heritage has had on dance. And to be honest with you, as an African myself, I'm Afro-Caribbean, I'm from Nigeria, I could relate 100% to a lot of the clips that you actually shared today. They were really very much on point. I cannot stress how important it is for these young minds to have something as like dance, as being something, it should be something that's compulsory for every single student to discover themselves, which is why I'm so glad this is being recorded. You know, Brian, fantastic job, that because many people should actually be made to listen to this particular presentation, because that begins the journey of self-discovery, which again, thank you for doing this. I mean, I don't have any questions. All I could do is just, you know, thank you for presenting such insightful information.
Glenn is in charge of the choir, the musical, all the instrumental, the pan, everything. Thank you, Glenn. Thank you.
And you're an inspiration.
The work we do here, and you know the uphill that it is. It is. But you see it, because you can also speak to the success of your students.
It's the same thing.
Yes. Yeah.
Exactly the same thing. Yeah. We can so identify with everything you have said, you know, which is why I'm glad it's been documented, you know, in this particular forum, because, like I say, everybody needs to be exposed to this level of insight that you have shared, you know, going all the way back to the 60s and the 70s and the 80s, and understanding our identity and understanding exactly where we come from. You know, it's so important for these young Caribbean minds to know exactly what their heritage is, you know, exactly.
And Glenn, thinking, I think you should do a lecture series on why is it that engineers are all musicians.
That's a very good one. You've really You've got my mind going. You know, coming
Brian,
in.
Brian, take notes so that Glenn can do that lecture series.
I am so in support of this. I'll do whatever I can to contribute, but it's amazing, really, really amazing. Yeah. And again, I'm so proud that UCCI has partnered with Brian and his team to make this happen in the National Museum. It's fantastic, fantastic.
Thanks, Glenn.
Thank you.
Wendy? Wendy?
Hi, Doc, can you hear me?
Yes, my darling, I can hear you.
Good night, everybody. Good night, Dr. Lawrence. I'm actually driving and dodging potholes at this point in time, but I could not miss it. But this is more of a statement as opposed to a question. I would just like you to know that your Stella Maris family misses you and loves you very much, as well as Jamaica. And I just want Cayman to know that she's only on a short loan.
Oh my goodness.
Miss you so very much. Love and this that. Was an excellent presentation.
Wendy.
I'm here.
Listen, Stephanie, remember you were asking about the impact it has on the young people? I've had Wendy from Wendy was teaching before Wendy knew how to read Join Up. And Wendy is now the associate director of Stella Maris Dance Ensemble before she knew how to reach Join Up. And her first play that she did, her line was, "Behold, the wise men cometh."
And you know how long it took me to learn that one.
So if you're talking about the impact within Stella Maris Dance Ensemble, we have financial analysts, we have two lawyers, we have three medical doctors. Yep, it does work, guys.
Envision yourself as winners.
Yeah,
winners.
Tisha.
Hi, Doc, how are you?
That's another one of my babies.
Yes, I'm actually from Jamaica as well, Stella Maris, for all who don't know me. And I was with you from the first group of kids. You remember the first pantomime that we did, Is Santa Coming? So yes. From that time. And one of the things that you mentioned, a couple of things actually. No question here, but just some of the things that resonated, in particular the coming out, we didn't know anything about coming out, coming into dance, like we were not exposed to it. So it wasn't until you were the one that taught us, the history of it, what it means, and we got like full history lessons when it came to that part of our culture that we wouldn't have learned otherwise. One of the things you mentioned about having kids in dance and in music, my children have to be in some sort of arts because of that, because I knew what it did to me as a person, growing up, when you have your focus on something, like it gets you so focused to, you get your school done, but because you need to go to dance, like you were very, very focused. And I thought that it helped a lot. That was one of the interviews that we had done. Like I remember in our 20s, I was in my final year at school at UA, and they had done an interview with a bunch of us senior dancers. And that was the thing that I said, actually, because we have rehearsals so many days, it makes you very focused at school, get what you need to get to rehearsals, So I think, as you said earlier, it's a complete disservice if they take these programs out of schools. I really think it's a disservice to students. And the other thing was our family, our dance family, like Wendy and I are so close.
Yes.
it's our family.
That you feel, it never.
It doesn't go away. Yeah. It doesn't go away. So I just wanted to just attest to everything that you had said. Incredible, incredible presentation. I couldn't take my eyes off of it. It was so good. A lot of insightful information. I just had to
them my two cents.
Thanks, my baby. Thanks, Keisha.
Of course.
Here's another one, Renita.
Hi, evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Well, mine is not really a question, but it's just to express thanks. Thanks to Brian for putting this together, which is amazing. And I second Dr. Lawrence's challenge to you to do a presentation on the quadrille. Please. Yes. And I just want to say, from the collaboration with Dr. Lawrence and Brian, having the opportunity to do the junk canoe was an absolute amazing experience for me. In primary school, you kind of learn about the quadrille and so on, but you learn more of its European essence and how that filtered into the culture. But with the junk canoe, I've listened to my father talk about it for years, and I've never seen it, only in pieces at Bahamas Carnival or so on, but never in Cayman. And to have the opportunity to learn it, to learn how it fits in with my culture, and to actually perform it for others who were also amazed and didn't realize that Cayman had this piece in their culture, this piece of Africanness that is also a part of who we are. It meant the world to me. And you don't get opportunities like that every day. And honestly, I've learned more about my Caymanian culture through dance and the performing arts than I have in any other form of educational platform. So I'm just saying thank you to the both of you for that experience. And thank you to my UCCI family, who is all here online.
Okay, thanks, Renita.
Mr. McGill, we'll end with you.
Yeah, I'm not going to take too much at the time. So I know I didn't join the dance group in Cayman. I would join it if I come back. But I remember when I started the Afro-Caribbean Club at this university in Canada. And we did a dance. And the amount of times I would have missed that dance, because that was something that I looked forward to, because the people that were dancing with, and when we watch ourselves do the moves, them, and as we would say, really express ourselves and come alive. It resonates with what my colleagues are saying, that the dancing brings an element where it brings all in one, you know, that happiness, I guess that high, one could say, but that community aspect, which really makes you want to be there, you want to perfect the craft. And you know, when you watch yourself and you say, boy, okay, you can do a little thing, it really makes you. And it was an African dance as well, and so it was a bit harder, because dancing to African can be a bit trickier if you're not accustomed, because there is a different rhythm to it. But you know, yeah, this is it's a really good, phenomenal presentation, Dr. Lawrence. And thank you so much. Yeah.
Thank you, Jared.
All right. Thank you all for joining us. Again, if you haven't completed the poll, just leave us your details so that we can update you on our next lectures. I'll give you a few minutes if you want to do that. But thank you all for joining us. I'll upload this on our social media. And have a good evening.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you both.
Monika, you were wonderful. Thank you, Brian. Good night, everybody.
Good night.
Night.
Night, everybody. Have a good night.
Have a good night.
Bye, Wendy. Keisha.
Dr. Mom, love you.
Kevin, you more. Made it.
I was here. I've been
you
here.
You made it on ear.
Yeah.
Oh, you made
Kevin!
It.
Reunion.
Hey, Doc. I miss you.
Hey, Miles. Next year.
Oh, but yes.